Today, we are going to open up our words. We're going to start in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, if you want to go ahead and go there. But we're going to talk about the importance of the Holy Ghost in your life, the Spirit of God leading you and guiding you. The more and more, you know, the day draws near of the coming of our Lord and Savior, I can feel His presence so strong on a daily basis. And I remember back when I was a younger teenager, even just listening to the men of God in my parents' lives talk about when the day approaches that people who know Christ, you feel closer and you feel stronger and you're so in tune with His Spirit. It's almost like, you know how when you're far away from somebody and you can hear their voice and you can make it out and recognize, you know, hey, that's so-and-so. I can recognize that voice, but you know, it's just faint, you know, you just kind of hear it and you're like, is that them? You know, I don't know. But when they get closer to you, you know, when they're like right there in your proximity, you know exactly who they are. You know exactly what they're saying. You can make out every single word, syllable. You even know the tone of their voice. Man, I feel like right now that is exactly where we are as a body of Christ. You know, you can sense the Holy Ghost if you're a believer. If you have a daily fellowship with the Holy Ghost, you can sense His voice like boom, immediately, like right there. And I just began to, you know, really seek God this past month. You know, the last podcast we talked about was just go and do what He said. And it was in a moment I was in Honduras, you know, in the presence of God, the Lord just quickened in my heart about knowing His plan. Because I know Him, because I allow the Spirit of Christ, the Holy Ghost inside of me, you know, bearing witness with each other that this is God's voice and this is the Spirit of God talking to me. This is just not some dream. It's not some idea. And so I want to talk to you today about the importance of praying in the Spirit and knowing the Spirit's voice and knowing that there's no time not to know the voice of the Spirit of God inside of your life. And so I want to talk to you about that today. I'm going to share probably a little bit of my testimony going through this podcast. And so I'm excited about that. All right. So if you have your Bibles, we're going to start in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 6. We're going to start in verse 6. So it says here, yet when I am among mature believers, I do speak with words of wisdom. Now, this is Paul talking to the church in Corinth. He, of course, begins this chapter talking about not coming in this full wisdom to immature believers, actually coming in power and demonstration to pretty much catch their attention, to make sure they know this is not just lofty words. It's not just some speech that is above their head, but this is truly with the power and demonstration of, you know, signs and wonders. But he goes on and says, but to the mature believers, I do come and I do speak wisdom, you know. And so this is what I want to encourage you with today. Verse 7, it says, no, the wisdom we speak of is a mystery of God. His plan was hidden, even though He made it for our ultimate glory before the world began. So the mystery of God was hidden. It was a mystery to everyone on the earth. But the rulers of this world, they didn't understand it. They would not have crucified our Lord if they did understand it, right? And it goes on, and it even says, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has imagined what God has prepared for those who love Him. If we were to stop right there, you know automatically, probably a lot of people use this. Man, you don't know what God has planned for you. You can't even understand it. You can't even believe it. And we talked about this the last podcast, just go and do what He said. If you have not heard it, I encourage you to go back and listen to that. But we're right here in the middle where people feel like they're blinded. They don't know. They're just living life. They just think that God is so far away that He doesn't really have a plan. You know, I just live my life. I just do whatever. But I'm telling you, this is not what it's talking about. It's saying to the blinded, to the unbeliever, or to the one that has not come to know the Holy Spirit inside of them. They're the ones that are saying, I don't understand. I don't see it. I don't know, you know, what God's doing in my life. But it says in verse 10, but it was to us that God revealed these things by His Spirit. Somebody say, by His Spirit. It is revealed to us by His Spirit. So if you're not in the know of your life circumstances, of how to get out of certain circumstances, even in your financial situations, your future, your children's future, I'm telling you, if you're not in the know, it's because you're not in the Spirit. There is no way you can tell me at this point in our lives, as close as we are to the coming of the Lord, that He doesn't want to reveal His plan for your life. It's not true. And don't allow religion to hold you in that place. Don't allow, you know, just the way that you've been brought up, or maybe the way that you've been taught in past, that it's just such a mind-boggling mystery the way our God is. No, our God is so gracious and so loving and so compassionate and tender to us that His desire is to reveal the fullness of His plan, the fullness of His glory, the fullness of who He is. This is what Paul was talking about, you know, when he says, I want to know Him. I mean, know Him. This is like know Him as in not just on surface level, but the deep revelation to know Him intimately, but not just that. To know the power of His resurrection, the power that Jesus Christ promised us as believers. This is the Holy Ghost power. He says, I want to know Him and the power of His resurrection and share in everything that He shared in, you know. And so this goes along with what He's saying here to the church of Corinth. He's saying, listen, God revealed these things to us by His Spirit. He goes on and says, for His Spirit searches out everything and shows us God's deep secrets. This is not just Paul. This is not just because he's an apostle. No, it's for every believer. The promise of the Holy Spirit is for every single believer. Peter preached this, you know, repent, come to the Lord, receive the promise He has for you and your children and your children's children. This didn't stop when the apostles died. You know, this was something that was passed down. Man, Jesus even prayed this in John chapter 17. You can go back and read that. John 17 was an entire prayer that He prayed for us, His disciples. He took time in His last hours on the face of this earth, and He began to pray, and His prayer mirrored exactly what He wants us to experience right now. Number one, that we're going to be rejected. But understand that we're only rejected because we bear the name of Jesus Christ. People may hate us. They may persecute us. They may badmouth us, whatever. But He says, you're going to see the presence of God like I saw the presence of God. You're going to walk in the same glory just as I have walked in. And He prayed this, Father, reveal to them, you know, just like You revealed to me. And He begins to talk about the promise. He begins to talk about, you know, the glory. He talks about how they're going to walk in the same manner. He begins to say, greater works we will do than Him. Why? Because He knew the future. I mean, think about that. He could only touch who He could touch in those moments. There wasn't social media. There wasn't YouTube. There wasn't podcasts. The message could not reach thousands of listeners and millions of listeners all throughout the world at the same time. Jesus knew greater works we were going to do because He knew exactly where we were going to be when He came back. And so He's encouraging us. He's mapping it out. You need to obey the Spirit like I obey the Spirit. You know, we know these things. Jesus had access to His Father. He was anointed. Acts 10:38. He was anointed by His Father to be upon this earth, to do good works, to heal the sick, to preach the good news, to deliver the oppressed. This was His mandate. And when He left, He passed that on to us. And He said, listen, I'm not going to leave you as orphans. You're not just going to have and bear My name. You're going to have the same Spirit that raised Me from the dead. You're going to have the same Spirit. It's the promise of the Holy Spirit. And why we aren't, you know, praying in the Spirit more, listening to the Spirit more, waiting for the Spirit and the prompting of the Holy Ghost before we do things, before we make decisions, before we, you know, even walk out of our house. We've got to be led by the Spirit of God. That's the difference between the Israelites being led in the desert to now. This is what he was talking to Abraham about. This was the promise of the Holy Spirit. His whole setup of the Old Testament was in direct reflection of how they lived then and what the promise was going to be for later. That it wasn't going to have to be a set of rules, a list of commandments. It wasn't going to have to be physically being led by a cloud or by, you know, pillar of fire. No, it was that inner witness in our belly, that deep witness of the Holy Ghost bearing witness with our spirit, our inner man, that we never have to walk outside of that. We don't have to make wrong decisions. We don't have to do guesswork. We can know the Spirit of God. And man, the more I search out scriptures, the more I realize we're not praying in the Spirit enough. You know, I was talking to my kids about this the other day. You know, I was just telling them that you never have to make a wrong decision. You don't have to make a wrong decision with who you're going to marry, with what direction you're going to head. Even in your school, you know, things are going to come to you. Temptations are going to come to you. But by your Spirit, if you pray in the Holy Ghost in that moment, don't tell me you're going to be led by your flesh. You can't be led in two different directions. How dumb of us to think that we can walk in the flesh and turn around and walk in the Spirit. We're constantly in two different directions. You know, we're either moving toward the Lord, we're moving toward his plan, we're moving toward his purpose, or we're not. It's one of two things, you know, and your flesh is going to lead you opposite. We know this. We know the scriptures. Galatians, right, talks about that. You know, Paul was, I mean, he was such a great, just a preacher of the difference between flesh and spirit. He mapped it out. Romans, Galatians. I mean, he mapped it out for the church today to understand we cannot be led by our flesh, because our flesh will reap destruction. It will lead us to go by our feelings, you know, our emotions. That's why Proverbs talks about our heart, that it is wicked. Why? Because our heart, it's like the seat of our thoughts, okay? It's pretty much guiding and leading us. And if this heart is not transformed, Ezekiel chapter 36 talks about this. That is why we have the different promise, a new covenant through Christ, which is receiving him and receiving the promise of the Holy Spirit. And he says this. In Ezekiel 36, it was a promise that when we come to know Christ, when we allow him to cut covenant with us and his blood is shed for us, it said he would rip out that heart of stone and he would put in a new heart, a new way of thinking. A heart is not the thing that beats. You know, your heart is your seat of thoughts. It is your throne of thoughts. Who is sitting on that throne? And that's what he's saying. I'm going to rip that old one out. I'm going to put a new one that is now responsive to the Holy Ghost, responsive to his commands, responsive to the voice of the Holy Ghost. And so, you know, this is not negotiable. This is how you know, man, I mean, Paul says this right in Romans. This is how you know you are a child of God, that you're led by the Spirit. We forget these scriptures somehow. I don't know. I have no clue why we feel like sometimes, I'm going to stop saying we, because I'm not that person anymore. I am a new creature in Christ. I'm not battling, you know, the sins of the flesh. I am every day exercising, walking in the Spirit. And you know what? When I fall short, you know it. And the Holy Ghost convicts you. And immediately you have an option. Repent and change, or don't. And you're going to keep walking in the flesh. You know, these are the scriptures that are in this word. Even Jesus, when he's talking on the Sermon on the Mount, he said, listen, don't come to me and offer your prayers and have conversation with me and act like everything's cool when you're over here holding odd against somebody. He said, don't even come to the altar and worship. Leave it. Leave whatever you think you're going to talk to me about. Go make it right and then come back. Do you know why Jesus is even referencing that? Because when you walk in the Spirit, you cannot gratify the desire of your flesh. You cannot stay in the mindset of pride. You can't. It will eat you up until you make it right. And this is the ways of Christ. But you don't have that without the power of the Holy Ghost working in your life. You know, you don't have that. You know, the Holy Ghost, his first job is to come and convict. We know this by John, right? John chapter 16, John chapter 14. Those chapters talk about the Holy Ghost, his role in our life. And you have to know this because his first job is to convict us, to convict the world of sin, to remind us that judgment is coming. But then his role in our life from that point is making us clean, renewing us, leading us, guiding us. I mean, this is part of his role. This is why it's so important to be led by the Spirit of God. And it's not like it used to be in the old covenant. It is actually that inner witness, bearing witness with him, that this is the will of God for your life. And it's important to know this. It's important to know for your life, for your decisions, for your plans. I don't want to miss God. I don't have time to miss God. I cannot be in a place right now where we miss God because people's lives are at stake. You know, July 15th, the Holy Ghost hit me. I mean, like a gut punch. I'm talking like almost knocking the wind out of me when I woke up that morning. And he said one phrase and three words: dream big, tent, trailer, truck. That was it. Immediately, I'm like, okay, I'm not thinking of this. This is something that just hit me. We had just come out of a crusade. It was a powerful crusade in our hometown. It was a part of a Love Out Loud outreach. You know, we got to borrow somebody's tent. It was really hot. The Lord orchestrated all of this. But in my mind, you know, I'm not thinking evangelistic crusades. I'm not thinking, you know, yes, I'm called to be an evangelist and I know God's call on my life. I know the scripture that he caused me to mirror my life after, which is go and preach to all nations and then, you know, be a light to the Gentiles, to the lost, you know, and then of course encourage the church, you know. So I know my assignment in that, but I didn't know the plan. You know, I didn't know step by step. I didn't know, okay, what does this look like? Am I going just going to continue doing mission trips? You know, I do missions. That's what people know me as. They know I have an evangelistic heart. But when he put that in my heart, dream big, tent, trailer, truck, I knew immediately, yeah, this is a dream big because this is something that I don't, you know, financially I'm thinking, yeah, I believe God for like $2,000 mission trips. You know, I've never went out and said by faith, yeah, tent, trailer, truck, that's about $100,000. No problem. You know, no, immediately what tries to come? Fear, doubt, questioning, reason. Okay, what about this? What about that? Is questions. But when you know the Spirit of God speaks to you, none of that mattered to me. It didn't matter about the fear, about the questions, about what are people going to think of me when I start telling them that God's called me to crusade evangelism and this kind of. I knew the inner voice of the Spirit of God inside of my heart saying, tent, trailer, truck. So what do? I immediately tell my husband. I immediately go to him and say, this is what I feel like the Lord spoke. And thank God for a husband who walks in the Spirit too. Because it wasn't doubt. It wasn't fear. He was like, let's go. What are we waiting on? You know, go and talk to my pastor. Guess what? Confirmation. You know, immediately confirmation. Confirmation to say, yes, this is exactly what God's been speaking to me. And I mean, we begin to like map out what this looks like in my life, you know, to go and to take a tent, a trailer, and a truck to Kentucky, to seven states surrounding Kentucky. Why? Because it's attached to a vision, a bigger vision that's been in my family's heart for 35 years. This stuff is is not birthed from just thinking about stuff. This was the inner witness in my heart. But this is the scripture, you know, I'm referring to today. God reveals these things by his Spirit, because his Spirit searches out everything and shows us God's deep secrets. No one can know a person's thoughts except that own person's spirit. And no one can know God's thoughts except God's Spirit. And we have received God's Spirit so we can know the wonderful things God has freely given to us. This is why it's so powerful. This is why it's so important to know God's Spirit. Because I could have just continued in my way of doing that and then heard that and said, yeah, no, that's just me. You know, that there's no way I could do that. But I knew that that was the Spirit of God hitting me. And then what do? I take it to prayer. I begin to pray in the Holy Ghost. And immediately in Honduras, God begins to put things in my heart. What we're going to do, how we're going to, you know, how the money's going to come in. And immediately August 15th, you know, I wake up and my retina's detached in my left eye, just out of the blue. Nothing happened, no issues, no trauma. It was an attack. And that morning I woke up and I remember praying in the Holy Ghost. I knew something was off. I had plans to go eat breakfast. I was at a hotel in Lexington. I told the girls that were with me. We were at a youth conference. I said, hey, we're going to get up. We're going to eat a big breakfast. They got a nice breakfast downstairs. I went down there. They started getting their plates and the Holy Ghost said, don't eat. And I'm just thinking, okay, I'll fast. It's a Saturday. We were in prayer and fasting that month. I'll just go ahead and fast, you know, and eat lunch, maybe with some youth ministers. And sure enough, within an hour and a half, my retina detaches. I'm in Louisville. I meet with my doctor. The first thing my surgeon says at 12:30 is, have you eaten today? If you have eaten, I cannot do this surgery. Now, if you don't know anything about retina surgeries, but retina surgeries are very time sensitive. So I had about an 80 to 90% chance of recovery, according to the doctors, if I would do that surgery that day. If I wait 2 days, that decreases a whole lot. You know, your vision and everything that heals decreases tremendously, very rapidly. So immediately I said, no, I have not eaten. You know, and the Holy Ghost hit me right then. You know, you're prepared for this. Don't worry. You know, I got you. And so no problem. I went to this surgery. Not a big deal. I knew God's hand was on me. I knew this recovery was not going to be what it was 3 years ago when my right eye retina detached. And it was a 12-week process. And it put me flat on my back for a long time. But I knew God's hand was on me greater than this attack that came to me. Why? Because of that inner witness, because of the Spirit of God inside me. That's why I couldn't be depressed. I couldn't be upset. You know, that first day I get up and I can't go to church and I'm sitting in my chair and I'm like, God, you told me tent, trailer, truck. You told me I have 3 months. Now I'm down to 2 months and I don't have any of the three. What, you know, but you know what, God, I trust you. I know you spoke this to me. And so I could have let those things come in and steal my joy. Then start reasoning. Well, you know, maybe that's for the future. Listen, we are in the future. There's no other future. Those scripture that says God has a plan for you, a plan, a future, and a hope. We are in the future. We are in your last days. You know, our time is running out on this earth. We have, yes, a future in glory. We are going to be with our Lord. We're going to reign as kings and priests upon this earth. We are going to have abundance of life. But I'm talking about the time that he's given you. You know, that parable of the talents. He's given each one of us talents. He's given us things to steward while he's gone. And when he comes back, he's going to require an account for what we've done with our talents. Listen, that's the future I'm talking about. We're in it. We're living it right now. You were born for such a time as this. And it's so vital that you get a hold of the life, everyday life in the Spirit, not in your flesh. Knowing and hearing, tuning your ear to his voice. Because according to the scriptures, the Spirit of God searches out everything and he reveals to you every single day what that day entails, what you need to be doing, how you need to be accomplishing his will for your life. It might say, you know, no mind can know and no, ear can hear, but not you. You can hear and you can know what the Spirit of God is saying to you. And so I couldn't get discouraged, you know, that my retina detached. I knew the recovery, but I knew my God. It wasn't that same day my husband comes home and says, babe, we got a trailer, a big trailer. I'm talking like an 8-foot by 25-foot trailer given to us. Next day, back, you know, in my little chair, because I got to look down, you know, for a retina surgery. One of the things that happens is they have to put a gas bubble in your eye. Well, this gas bubble is not anything to play with, or, you know, there's very specific instructions. So my instructions were, I have to look down for about 3 weeks. I can't look up. I have to keep my head down because I have to keep this gas bubble in position. So my Bible's in front of me, my laptop's in front of me, my phone's in front of me. Like, everything I do has to be facing down, right? So sure enough, this is my position. But I could not let that discourage me. It was not going to be a blow backwards. It wasn't going to be a step. It was actually going to be, now I'm just going to sit and wait on the Lord. I'm going to pray in the Holy Ghost. I'm going to hear him even clearer on what to do today, what to do tomorrow. And sure enough, next day, I mean, my tent or my trailer, the complete wraparound paid for. Again, I have not at this point done anything but prayed in the Holy Ghost. And God's will, man, where his will is known, faith is so much easier. Because when you know it's God, you don't have to fear. You don't have to worry. You don't have to, oh my gosh, what are we going to do? You just sit, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, right? This is what I did. A couple days after that, a truck comes up. You know, and then the pressure comes, you know, what do? We need a truck. Trucks are very hard to find. You know, here's one in Nashville. We have the opportunity to go pick it up and I have to pull the trigger. I talked to my husband. He's like, babe, I think we should do it. In my mind, I'm thinking, how in the world can I sit here and drop 50 grand on a truck? I don't have 50 grand in my pocket. I don't have, you know, support coming in worth 50 grand in the next week. But here's the thing. In my spirit, I had peace. Yep, get the truck. Guess what? Get the truck. Not even a week later, truck is paid off. I haven't even talked about it. You know, I haven't even really got to voice everything that God is doing with this past month of tent, trailer, truck. And the truck is paid for. I'm talking about a nice truck, a 2019 Silverado 2500 diesel. It's a big boy truck, right? But here's the thing. God is so faithful that if you'll just obey his spirit. So when I knew the Spirit of God hit me, faith comes, because where the will of God is known, faith is there. Faith is strong. Faith can increase. And this is what's happening in our lives today, is that God is going to launch us into this evangelism crusade ministry. And I know it. And I'm not afraid. I'm not hesitant. I'm not fearful about it. I'm excited. I'm waiting. I'm praying in the Holy Ghost. And I'm waiting for that next, do this. Next is the tent. We're down to about 16 days. Because God told me 3 months. In 3 months, I would have a tent, trailer, and truck. I got my trailer. I have my truck. It's a beautiful truck. And guess what? Within 16 days, I'm going to have that tent and it's going to be paid for. I'm not worried. I'm not on social media trying to raise funds. I'm not, you know, launching some fundraiser campaign. I'm not, none of that. I know God spoke. And so through his spirit, he has led me every single step of the way to hear his voice, to know what he wants me to do, and to walk in that. So I'm just waiting on that next step. And I'm not afraid. In your life, you can experience the same type of presence of God in your life. When you fellowship with the Holy Ghost, he does not lead you. It's a promise. Think about this. When God spoke to Abraham and said, Abraham, I want you to get out of this country, leave your family, and go to the place I have called you. I am going to make you a great nation. He began to prophesy over his future. And Abraham had a choice. Do I put my trust in the Lord, or do I continue to stay where I am and basically lean on my own trying, on my own what I've built here? And he had a choice. And thank God he chose wisely. He obeyed the voice of the Lord. This is where our promises come from. This is where the promises of Abraham are stemmed from. The promise of the Holy Ghost. It started way back when Abraham left his father and his mother and his lands and everything that he had, and he obeyed the voice of the Lord. Everything came to him because of that decision. There were times he did it wrong. There were times he made wrong decisions. But he went back to that inner witness. God spoke to me and told me to do this. It's no different with your plans today. There are things that the Holy Ghost has dropped in your spirit, and it's time to move on them. It's time to obey his spirit versus what your head tells you, what everybody else around you does. You've got to be obedient to the Spirit of God. If I was not obedient in that moment to begin to just trust God, I could have completely missed what God wanted to do to bring me the trailer, to bring me the truck, and the tent eventually. But I'm not, because his word is proven out. Man, I didn't even really get to all the scriptures I want to get to today, but this is his word. His word talks about the promise of the Holy Spirit. And I want to talk to you more about this. This is something I want to continue with. And I want to strengthen your faith today that you don't have to be clueless. You don't have to be wondering. There is never a day you have to be in confusion, because our God is not a God of confusion. He speaks to us clearly. Jesus said he is the shepherd and his sheep know his voice. Do you know how? Through the promise of the Holy Ghost, through that inner witness of the Holy Ghost. So if you've had trouble hearing clearly the plan of God for your life, you're kind of in those moments, or maybe you're in transition and you don't know which step to take, I'm telling you, stop trying to figure it out with your brain and just go to God in prayer. Pray in the Spirit. Paul said, I pray more in the Spirit than I do in my natural mind. Do you know why? Because the Spirit searches out the deep things of God. I want to read to you one more scripture. Romans chapter 8, verse 26. It says, and the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. For example, we don't know what God wants us to pray for, but the Holy Spirit prays for us with groanings that cannot be expressed in words. And the Father who knows all hearts knows what the Spirit is saying, for the Spirit pleads for us believers in harmony with God's own will. And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them. Man, this is powerful. Proverbs 25 says, counsel in the heart of man is like a deep water, but a man of understanding will draw it out. Psalm 139:1 says, O Lord, you've examined my heart and you know everything. It goes on and on, scriptures about how God searches our hearts. He searches here, and the Spirit of God will begin to reveal and deal with the things that are in our heart. Deal with the questions. Deal with the concerns. Deal with any type of doubt or fear. God will deal with those things if we allow the Spirit of God to really come alive in our heart. When we begin to pray in the Spirit, when we truly allow time on a daily basis to pray in the Spirit, pray in not your natural language, in the Spirit. And you think, to me, it doesn't profit. I'm telling you, it profits your spirit. Because when your spirit can begin to speak to you versus this head right here, things make sense, because it is the direction of God. It's the peace of God. It's the plan of God. And you don't have to earn it. You don't have to work for it. You walk in it. That is the promise that God meant for us to have, is that we have a daily inner witness inside of us. We have a daily relationship with him through his spirit. So I want to encourage you today. You know, don't think that you're walking this alone. When God says he is God Emmanuel, He is with us. It is because of the promise of the Holy Spirit. He never leaves you, and he's with you. He is a promise to comfort you, to guide you, to lead you. That's why we can have peace in these crazy times that we're in. We can have full peace. Jesus reminded us, do not let your heart be troubled, because you know you have the Holy Spirit, whom I am sending you. Good God, if you're not filled with the Holy Ghost today, get filled with the Holy Ghost. You can right now, where you're sitting, where you're listening. You can say, God, baptize me in your Holy Spirit. Fill me with from the innermost being, rivers of living water flowing out of me. And God will fill you right where you are, because it's a promise for you. It's a promise for your children. And you do not want to walk without the promise of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, let me pray for you, because I believe God is doing something in your heart right now. I know God is wanting to get your ears more in tune with his Spirit. And so you got to get your spirit life happening. I'm talking daily. I'm talking about praying in the Spirit daily. Amen. Let me pray for you today. Father, we just thank you right now. Every listener at the sound of my voice, I thank you, God, that your Spirit right now is bearing witness with their spirit, with their heart, God, that you desire to be closer. You desire to speak to them, to reveal to them. I pray today, God, that they will have the understanding today of the presence of God in their life, that they will begin to desire to pray in the Spirit, desire spiritual gifts, desire the things that accompany the Holy Ghost. I thank you today, every person that's not filled with your Spirit right now, through these radio waves, through this technology, God, right now in the name of Jesus, we just pray that the Holy Ghost will come into their room right now and feel them where they are. Right now, by your Spirit, fill them with your presence. I thank you, Father, for your presence is manifesting right now, manifesting in the hearts and minds of those who are listening. I thank you, God, that every good gift you give freely and is a good gift. So I thank you for the promise of the Holy Ghost in our lives. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, amen.